Hello, my name is Daniel Towsey, also known as a truth soldier on the internet. I have spent my life fighting for truth, justice, and liberty. I have been a victim of horrific experiences at the hands of evil people. I have written writing about a lot of these things and what's happening to me and this planet and many other people for many years. And I've just decided that I'm going to start using my camera and doing testimonies as to what I'm going through personally, because writing, it takes a long time, it's very difficult, and I figured that it's easier for you to listen to me than just to read my notes. I'm hoping that you will take my videos and pass them around and have other people listen to them and understand that I am not a lunatic or crazy or anything else. I have written many things in my life, from on a whole spectrum of the most beautiful things to the most evil things going on in this world. And right now I'm doing this as my first testimonial, and I want you to know that if you read my article, How to Assassinate a Cyclist, you'll discover that some people deliberately drove a car over me, seriously injuring me, traumatizing me for the rest of my life, leaving me with horrific injuries. And I'm going to tell you what my injuries are right now, so that you understand how strong a human being I am and how God is helping me to stay alive. I don't care if you believe in God or not, but if you don't, just keep listening to the rest of what I have to say. You'll find this pretty extraordinary. At present, I am being denied medical care, all medical care. I have no family doctor, I am not seeing any specialists, and on top of that, I cannot sue the insurance company of the supposed woman that ran her car over me for damages, because my lawyer advises me that he can't get a doctor to do the medical reports that are necessary for court. In the last year and a half, I've gone through 9 different family doctors that I've visited or attended or met, and every single one of them was influenced by outside forces, basically advising them as to the limited service that they're going to be allowed to provide me. I've heard these family doctors tell me that they can't deal with my case because it's too complicated, there's too much paperwork, too many files, too many x-rays, too many things. I've been told by these family doctors that the province of Nova Scotia does not pay them to answer telephones for me, call people, do faxes, write letters, do reports, or anything else for that matter. And the doctors have refused to do all these things. It has been a horrible, horrible, horrible fight for me to be able to get the basic necessities of things that I need to try to survive, try to live my life. My health presently is very bad, and it's deteriorating constantly. I will now tell you what my injuries are. And I'm sorry if some people will get upset, but I have to do this as a public testimony. As who knows, maybe one day they'll succeed in killing me, as they're still trying to do. Since my accident, I've had 3 serious incidents of cars at full speed driving towards me, trying to knock me off my wheelchair to kill me. And I have no protection by the police or anyone else. All the government officials and everyone that I've talked to appear to have been seriously influenced by who I suspect is CSIS. Because my problems, if you read my first article, if you read my first article, Corrupt Canadian Elections, you'll understand when this started. At present, I can describe to you a little bit about the car accident so you understand my present injuries from that car accident. It's not even an accident. It was done deliberate. The car aimed at me while I was riding my bicycle by. I had stopped my bike completely when the car pulled out at full speed, aiming at me. I stopped my bicycle 2 feet short of the car. The car stopped put its brakes on really hard because I stopped really quickly. It turned its wheels, aimed at me, knocked me off my bicycle, and went flying backwards. I blanked out for a few seconds. And my bicycle had been removed off the street by the assistants that were standing at the sidewalk behind me, and they hid my bicycle. Then the car slowly drove towards me as I laid on my side. The only part of my body that wasn't under the car was my head, and I had a bicycle helmet on, a very good one. The car came rolling up slowly and put the tire rested against my right shoulder, which was up high, and my left shoulder was on the ground. And there's this big tire right beside me, and the engine, I'm underneath the car, and the engine's right above me, and this is not a small car, and the engine is very big and heavy. Anyway, the car is sitting there crushing me, and breaking my shoulders, and breaking my ribs, and the car broke my back. And my T8 bone has been compressed by over 90%, meaning it doesn't exist anymore, meaning I'm in two pieces. Which is a medical miracle the doctors can't understand and are afraid to even mention. When the car was crushing me, I decided that I only had one option left because the car had its tire turned all the way to the left because it had turned all the way to the left to aim at me. And I knew that if a person is pushing on the gas, which this person did continuously, never put their brakes on once, I knew that the weight of the car was shifting to the right side. I was under the left side. So I did the only thing left to do, and I forced my body flat on the ground as quickly as I could because the car was killing me. If I had stayed in that position a few seconds longer, I'd be dead right now. I took a chance and I flattened myself down, and the car jumped. And as it jumped, the steering wheel turned to the right because the driver didn't expect the pressure to be relieved that quickly. So the tire drove right over my right shoulder, but as the tire climbed over my body, it literally tore my right arm off my body, and my shoulder was destroyed in the process. But my arm stayed attached because I was lying on the ground. The top of my arm and shoulder were shattered beyond repair. They had to remove the top part of my arm, cut it off, you know, and put a plastic piece in there. They had to take all my muscles and disconnect them from my shattered bones and tie them onto the prosthesis, so that now my right arm is there, but it's not really very attached to my body. I no longer have any use of my right shoulder, basically. I'll get into the difficulties of my injuries a little later. I'll explain more about it. The car jumped over me and drove from my right shoulder right past my face, right, not even a quarter of an inch from my lips. And it drove down on an angle from my right shoulder to my left hip. And on the way through, the car crushed everything. It broke my bone, my ribs everywhere. I have so many broken ribs. I know there's at least 9 that are broken. But 9 broken ribs can mean that I have 15 breaks. I have many other ribs that are cracked. My large intestine was burst, and I lost that. They had to take it out. And the car did damage to my left hip. So after the car that drove over me, the driver had stopped because the driver looked to the right. My head was the only part of me that wasn't under the car. So I was lying there in excruciating pain, looking up at the driver, which was right above me, looking to the right, to her right, for a clearance in the traffic so that the driver could take off. When that driver saw an opening, I heard the engine gun. The driver floored the car, and I realized at that time, oh my God, this car is going to drive over my knees now with the back tire at full speed. I stopped moving and wiggling like I was in pain, and I flattened my legs down as fast as I could. And when the car went over my knees, it did a lot of cartilage damage that is going to continue to deteriorate my knees the rest of my life. And it also shook my legs so hard that it damaged both my hips. Because my legs were like jelly, and they were just like shaking so hard from this weight and the speed of this car that it damaged my cartilage and my joints of my knees. And now I can tell you more some other time about the actual accident, but I'm going to tell you now what kind of injuries that I have today that I'm dealing with. The loss of my large intestine has made it so difficult for me to eat food, to digest food, to process nutrients. I've been told that the large intestine is what cleans your fluids, provides you with blood, and the large intestine serves a very, very serious function. So now I have extremely uncomfortable abdomen pains constantly all day long. The inside of my body has got a big, huge, empty cavity now. When I try to stand up, my knees bounce, my hips hurt me, and my insides, my ribs, behind my ribs, are all moving around. My body bounces really bad when I walk very slowly. I live in an apartment that has a carpeted floor. I walk very little, and I walk very short distances because the pain becomes completely unbearable. I have so many injuries and so many complications and so many difficulties. It's extraordinary to believe this is even real. It's amazing to believe that I'm even alive. even in this video, I wouldn't have time to tell you all the complexities of my life right now. But I'm going to try to do my best right now to tell you more so you understand that I am an extraordinary human being, because there's no way anyone else should be able to live through what I'm going through. I've been told by doctors that my injuries are medically unsurvivable. They've looked at my x-rays in complete shock and look at my body and realize I'm in two pieces and they don't even know how I'm alive. I've had people tell me they've done research all through North America trying to find another case like mine of anyone surviving what I've gone through, and they said it's never occurred before. My injuries and my difficulties in my life are making it so that all government regulations and rules and everything else that exists right now don't even come close to applying to my unique case. I'll give you an example of some of my daily difficulties. When I try to go to bed at nighttime, I never know if I'm going to sleep or not. I don't know if I'm going to sleep a half an hour, or whatever, but I never get a good night's sleep. I'd like you to know, too, that I don't pass a second of the day that I'm not in excruciating pain all over my body. Every movement I make, even talking, is extremely painful. But I'll get back to the bed thing, and I'm going to do more to explain my other difficulties, too. When I go to bed, I have a hospital bed that took me a year to fight for it to get it. It has a very thick foam mattress, because my body has got so many broken bones everywhere that lying down is extremely dangerous and difficult. I have to elevate the back of the bed, the head where the pillow is, so I elevate it right up so I can get in bed. I tilt the bed backwards a bit because I can't stay laying on my back more than about a minute. I have actually four pillows on my bed. When I lay my body down flat, I can only lie on my left-hand side. Slightly on my left. I can't lie on my back, I cannot lie on my stomach, and I cannot lie on my right side. I have a very heavy, big pillow that I use. I put it under my stomach and under my right, between my legs, to hold my legs in place and to hold my abdomen and my stomach up and my rib cage in place. I have to use another pillow to hold my right arm in place, to hold it up, because it's completely not attached to my body, basically. And when I think that I might be able to manage a position that doesn't give me any pain, I try to fall asleep. And then I pray that my stomach, my abdomen, my guts, my intestines that are missing, I don't have horrible pressure and pain and gas problems and everything else that's occurring in my gut, which I don't fully understand. And when that happens, if my gut is hurting me, I can't sleep at all. There's days that I have to sit, I get out of bed and just sit down. You know, I have many, many more problems. I'll give you an example of what I go through. In my home, I have a dining room with normal chairs. I can't use those chairs because they're wood and I can't sit in them. In my living room, I can't use my furniture. I can't sit on it because I need arm supports that is very high to hold my arms up because my shoulders are both broken. All the ribs attached to my shoulder blades are broken or cracked. My neck has severe injuries where the more I move my head, the more pain I have, to the point where my head gets kinked sideways if I keep moving it. When I go out of my wheelchair, I have to wear a neck brace. If people ever visit me in my home and I'm not wearing my neck brace, when I start moving my head around to try to communicate with people, eventually I can't move my head. You know, it may sound like I'm going all over the place in this story that I'm telling, because it's not a story, but there's no easy way to explain this. I have many more problems than what I've just told you, and I'm going to try to tell you some more of them as best as I can understand them. When I got out of the hospital a year and a half ago approximately, this occurred to me November 22nd, 2009. I was in complete trauma, mentally and physically. I went from being a very exceptionally strong human being. At 53 years old, I was able to move furniture, do anything. I was a mechanic. I was a welder. I could renovate houses. I had all kinds of skills. I went from being a very active person, riding a mountain bike, a bicycle that is, anywhere I wanted. And as time has gone by, I've watched my body slowly deteriorate. People have asked me, are you going to recover? I said, never. I said, I'm going to keep losing my strength because my bones are broken everywhere. And I can't use the muscles that are attached to those bones, especially all my broken ribs and my shoulders and everything else that's wrong with me. And I'm slowly deteriorating. My breathing is getting more difficult. I have pleaded for help from people. I've been denied all help. And I know, absolutely beyond any doubt, that CSIS and government agents interfere in every aspect of my life like they've always done. And anyone who tries to offer me help is basically stopped. You know, there's good people around, but they're afraid to help me because the government agents that are doing this harm to me are pretty powerful and pretty scary. But besides that, I've been trying to deal with my physical limitations and my problems. Every single day of my life now is a change, and my health is different. It's a constant nightmare trying to adapt to understand what is happening to my body. When I arrived at the hospital, I was classified as a multiple trauma victim. And I was told that classification is rarely given to anyone because a trauma victim is one that's about to die unless they get immediate help. To be a multiple trauma victim is considered very serious. I have to pause here because I'm losing track because there's so many things. Oh, yes. When I was in the hospital at the beginning, after I received some medical care, I started being attacked by people verbally. And then they actually shipped me out of the hospital I was in and sent me to another hospital and refused to help me at the original hospital I was in. So a few days later, when I was able to get some idea of who I am and what's going on, because the first week in the hospital, I was so heavily medicated, I was completely out of my mind. I didn't even know. I was not conscious of what I was saying. But I got an idea from people that I was saying some pretty lunatic things, but that doesn't matter to me. And a week later, as I started coming out, I was on morphine, and I think I had 9 different major prescriptions for painkilling. And I knew enough to know about painkillers that if you stay on them, they'll destroy your body and your mind. I told the people in the hospital that by the time I leave this hospital, I will be off all medications. And they thought I was crazy, so that's impossible because of the amount of pain I must have, and I did have. And I took my time and I told them, you're only going to give me medication when I ask for it. And I kept weeding myself slowly off and off. And that was so difficult to do. My body is so damaged that any movement I do, whether it's in the wheelchair I'm in or in bed, every time I try to use my torso or different parts of my muscles, my body sweats really horribly. The muscles are working so hard because they're so damaged that they create all kinds of heat. When I lie in bed at nighttime, I have to have a fan on beside me because I completely soak my bed most of the time. My upper torso is just sweating like crazy because the trauma I have is so serious. You know, there's so many things. I'll just sound like I'm ranting and raving, but I'm not. Since I got out of the hospital, I had to change my location where I live. I had to move to an accessible building. You know, I had to go through all kinds of horrible changes. Just to show you how bad my situation is, at present, and for the last year and a half since I moved into this apartment, actually just over a year, I've been unable to do my laundry. I have home care workers that come twice a month and or every 2 weeks, and they used to do my laundry at my other building where I live, but that's because the laundromat was right outside the building. In this building, it's a 3-story building with 12 apartments, and they're all families, and there's only one washer and dryer, and usually those don't work. And when the home care workers come, they can't come and do my laundry because they can't stay here all day long doing 2 or 3 loads. So my laundry hasn't been done. I've been going to a church to get free clothing so I'd have clean clothes to wear. Last winter, I was stranded in my home and I couldn't go out and do my groceries at all because I couldn't leave my building because it's a long story, but being in a wheelchair in the wintertime, the windshield alone can kill you. It's so freezing cold when you're moving in a chair. But I couldn't go out and get my groceries, and I appealed to people to help me, and no one came to my aid. CSIS has done such a good job of vilifying me with anyone I communicate with that people kept thinking I must be crazy or nuts or whatever, I deserve what I got, blah, blah, blah. I hear all kinds of thoughts and ideas from people. But you know, I've been publishing online the whole truth of what's been going on in this world and in my life for many years. And slowly, everywhere I go, people are slowly realizing that I'm not the lunatic and I'm not crazy. I'm actually quite the exception to everything. And I'm the only human being that's risked his whole life to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth, so help me God. So now, getting back to my injuries, I'd like you to understand, too, that I've now got almost no use of my right arm. I can move my arm at the elbow. Luckily, I can do that because it means I can steer the wheelchair. My muscles are continually whittling away. My legs are become extremely thin. I'm basically at the strength of a 100-year-old man right now. I walk around in my apartment from one room to the other once in a while. I sit in my orthopedic chair in front of my computer, which is basically a very fancy office chair with elevated armrests so that I have a way to hold my body straight. Because without the armrest, I can't sit down. And I sit here and I go through my internet research. Anyway, getting back to my injuries. When I was 20 years old, approximately at that age, I was an apprentice carpenter working at a place that was run by the military in the U.S. in Canada, in Toronto. And the guy there basically set it up so that I'd injure myself in a saw, and I ended up cutting four of my fingers pretty well right off my left hand. So I had microsurgery done, and my fingers were reattached, but I had real limited use of my left hand most of my life. And I managed pretty well, considering that I had a pretty significant injury there. So now, my right arm is not useful to me. I have very little strength, and my left hand is not very useful, and my left shoulder is so damaged that, and my back is broken, and my ribs are broken, that I can barely carry anything. And carrying anything and lifting up anything is an extreme risk every time I do that, because I risk breaking something else, or tearing my arm off, or breaking my muscles, or whatever else. And I realized that I can stand up straight and not move for a minute, and I can look perfectly normal. And you know, when I go around in my wheelchair, people look at me, and many people don't even believe me that I have all these injuries. They can't even comprehend the amount of suffering that I go through every single day. And I still manage to be nice to people and smile and try to avoid the pain that I'm in. And I knew I had to get off of all those medications, because I knew that if I didn't listen to my body every time I tried to move or do anything, that if I didn't listen to the pain signals that I was getting, that I would further injure myself. And I knew that medications would numb me so badly that I would end up really injuring myself and possibly killing myself or permanently crippling myself to the point where I can't function at all. I knew that medication was not an option. It's been a year and a half. The insurance company has not paid me a penny. He's not going to, by the looks of things. I've had to fight with every government agency that exists for every basic thing that I need in my life, and I'm still fighting, and I still don't have the things that I need. I have no community support from anyone at all. And I sit here and realize that, you know, I have not done any harm to people, even though people have claimed that I have. You know, my family was affected by CSIS, and I lost my first family because of the CSIS activities, and CSIS got involved with my second family and also did me a lot of serious harm. My daughters, my two daughters, my youngest ones, have grown up with the idea that I have done something wrong or bad to them, which I never did. I have no real contact with them. I do talk to them, but I barely know them anymore. They don't talk to me. They never call me. You know, they just say hi once in a while, but I have basically no contact with my family. And it's amazing to me that I've been an honest human being all my life and I have to go through this. I'm just going to lift up my camera to see how much time is left. It's still recording. If my camera shuts off, I'll just restart another video, because I don't know how long it'll record for. And the reason why I'm doing this is to let you know that my injuries are extremely extraordinary, extremely bad. I'm not too sure if I mentioned all my physical difficulties, but there's a lot of them. The apartment that I live in, understand that it's a carpeted floor. I have special shoes to walk with, and I can walk slowly, and I'm bumping into doorways and things as it is now, because I live in what's called a barrier-free apartment, so there's enough room between the furniture and the walls and things that I can walk around. Having friends come over to my apartment is about the only way I ever see anybody. But you know something? Do you know how hard it is to live, to walk around in my apartment, to socialize and do things with people, and try to hide all my pain and suffering and my difficulties in movement from them? So because if they see my pain, it affects their personality towards me. So that people don't realize how strong I am, and I go out and I hide all my pain. Because I know that the more pain that they see that I'm going through, the more the barrier becomes between me and other people. Being disabled, guys, is really extraordinary. But it's one thing to be disabled, but it's another thing to be in excruciating chronic pain all day long. Every movement I make, whether it's my head, my shoulders, my hands, everything, it's all with extreme difficulty and pain. You know, I absolutely do believe that God has a mission for me, and it's the reason why he saved my life on that day, because I know I died. I know. You can read my How to Assassinate a Cyclist. It's written very clearly for you. So here I am sitting here in my office with my camera pointing at the ceiling, doing this video in hopes that somebody will listen to it and realize that I am who I am. I am Daniel Tausi, and I have been an honest human being all my life, and I've strived to seek and speak the truth my whole life, which has turned out to have make me very strong and very intelligent, because I choose to be sane, because I realized long ago that truth is an absolute, and the absolute opposite of truth is insanity, and I chose not to be insane. But I've watched our world as the insane are destroying it, destroying people's minds and souls, destroying our water, our environment, our air, our skies, everything. So I endeavored on the most amazing thing. I realized I had to seed the seeds of truth with my writings. And I realized that people would often think that, oh, the guy must be nuts, this can't be possible. And I've often told people, I said, please don't think it's the messenger that's insane. The messenger is only telling you what the insane are doing. People today have been socially engineered to the point where they have no idea what the truth is, nor do they care what the truth is. People have all been told, hey, be selfish, me, me, me. And the more selfish people become, the easier they are to control, because the less unified they are with their neighbors and their friends and other people. I've watched all this destruction happening in this world. And today all I see is people that are completely caught up with material things. They don't care that the Gulf of Mexico has been destroyed by BP. They don't care that Yugoslavia has been destroyed completely and doesn't exist anymore. They don't care about everything. They don't care about Japan's tsunami being caused by the American military setting off some nukes under the surface of the ocean, lifting up a plate of the ocean which flooded Japan. There was no big 9 earthquake. There wasn't even a 6 earthquake. If you look at the videos from Japan, you'll see that there was no structural damage to any of the buildings or cities or any towns that were washed out by the tsunami. The people were all going about their business, and I watched these horrifying videos as these big waves washed over all these cities and killed probably millions of people. I found out here that Fukushima has 6 nuclear reactors, and one of them is plutonium. And anyway, look, there's a lot of information available on this. But this disaster, the reason why they sabotaged the plants with the Stuxnet, whatever they call it, that virus that Israel put in there, was to unleash this radiation so that the world wouldn't realize that the Americans had actually used nuclear weapons in the ocean to cause the tsunami. Because Japan had asked the USA to leave their land. And the USA has 14 bases there. And Japan was, the other story that's being told is that Japan was going to refine uranium for the Iranians to have nuclear power to produce electricity with, and not weapons. Anyway, getting back to me, okay. You know, the reason why people have attacked me is because Bob Kaplan in 1984 put out a contract on me when he created CSIS during that campaign, the federal election campaign that I worked on against him. And I've been a victim of covert agencies ever since. Think what you want, call me crazy, it doesn't matter to me, because I know I'm not. If you want proof of who I am or what I have to say and all the things that I've described so far and a lot more, go online and type in a true soldier or Daniel J. Tausi and go do some reading. You know, the public doesn't attack me. Everywhere I go on the streets in Halifax or anywhere else I go, people don't attack me. Even on the internet, with all my articles published everywhere in the world, nobody's attacking me. Because they all realize I'm telling the whole truth and nothing but the truth. You know, I know God is real. Go have a look at my picture called the Son of God. It's the real thing. God showed me an amazing sign. He put a great big heart in the sky. The sun turned from a normal sun to 3 times its normal size and became a huge heart. If you go to DanielTausi@Photoshop.com, you can go download the original and show it to anybody you want. That'll all tell you it's real. Then you can go look at all the other pictures in the series showing you where the sun changed its shape. And if that's not a clear enough message of who I am and what I'm doing on this planet and why I've told the truth and the whole truth my whole life, because I'm hoping that you people will understand that Jesus, a long time ago, told us to do as he did, not to follow him. And it's the same thing I'm telling you now. But the difference between me and Jesus is that I've been writing it all out for you. But you know something? The chemtrails in the sky that they've been spraying, and the HARPA program that they use to create to control the weather and earthquakes and everything else they're doing. People, please understand. There's good and bad, and if the good people do nothing, the bad will run the world. And the evil, the insane are running the world. Because the opposite of truth is insanity. Truth is an absolute, and the absolute opposite is insanity. And the insane, with their power of money, the creation of their first corporation, which is, I wrote an article about, they really are destroying this planet, folks. And if you go read my article called They Want You Dead, is written in stone, it's quite clear that they've been had this agenda for a very long time to just kill everybody off. But they're completely insane, these people. They want to nuke the planet. They're flooding the USA with the chemtrails, with their chemtrails control. They're flooding the USA, and the list doesn't end. Look, I'm not crazy. All I'm doing is telling you the same stuff that Jesse Ventura was telling you about. But Jesse Ventura has been reading my stuff. So has Alex Jones, and so has a lot of other people. You know, people, if you've got any ability to think anymore, if the fluoride hasn't completely weakened you, to the point where you have no reaction to anything anymore, hopefully maybe I can give you some strength here and make you realize, look, I'm not crazy. It's time for all you people to wake up and realize, unless you seek the truth, we're all doomed. And in the end, when you seek the truth, remember, you can't put conditions on truth. You can't know what the truth is. You have to blindly seek it. Because the light of truth is actually very blinding to people who live in the darkness. Because people who live in the darkness don't know any truth. So the bottom line is very simple. Truth is very, very simple. And God is the simple truth. And remember that Jesus never went to church. They didn't exist. He never wrote anything. He just told the truth. And by telling the truth, he was spreading love. Because truth cannot exist without love. And all God is asking you to do is to be truthful. And if you are pure in truth, you will know God. And if you know God, then God will love you and you will love God back. And that's how it all works. Amen.